It's being described as a chaotic scene as people flee an apartment complex on fire Thursday afternoon.
I just saw the flames shooting out of the window.
I got here shortly after that, and there were flames coming from the fourth floor.
And from those flames, three people have died. Fire officials say more than 60 people live in the apartment complex, and right now, all of them are without a home.
And Polk County Emergency Management's here, so they're going to take care of that piece, making sure that we've got some place for the residents here to go and be safe.
Authorities say the fire was the fiercest on the top floor, but there is no cause yet. Because of the nature of it, the fire department did put out a second alarm. More than 50 firefighters and recruits were on scene assisting at one point.
In my opinion, they behaved and acted very heroically and aggressively to get the fire contained as quickly as they did and to get all of the victims accounted for and out of the building.
The inside of the iconic Golden Dome of the Iowa State Capitol is slowly crumbling away. That's why scaffolding now surrounds the dome as work is underway to make much needed repairs.
Beyond the stories of scaffolding is the work you can't see from below.
Are you guys taking us to this window?
To get there, our first climbed the winding staircase up to the Whispering Gallery. We then got a look not many people can get.
Oh my goodness.
Do you ever get scared going up here?
You get used to it.
Contractor Scott Ritchell showed us repair work underway while our Sky 8 drone flew above, catching our climb to the top.
Not too many people get to come to work and have this kind of view.
To get inside the Golden Dome, you climb through a window, and then you see it. The thousands of bricks deteriorating from decades of condensation. Bricklayers are now grinding, cutting, and relaying bricks before it's too late to replace them.
Relaying new brick.
Chad Fredrigill is from a family of bricklayers going back to when the Capitol was built.
They've asked me if I'm channeling my grandpa because he's passed away now, and he worked on this for the first 9 years on the last restoration of the outside.
And while the dome is being repaired, they're making other fixes too, like patching stone and replacing glass.
Degree of difficulty working in it, you know, just because where you got to get to, but it's the most beautiful building in the world, I think.
This renovation will make sure the more than century-old dome stays a symbol of Iowa for decades to come. On top of the Iowa State Capitol, I'm Tommy Clark.
I actually told my wife last night when we left, I said, I forgot to lock that front door.
Despite the damage, Wayne Coffey and his family are considering themselves lucky.
And we made it couple steps down in there, and then the whole thing just went flying.
Their home damaged beyond repair.
First thing we seen when we come up out of the basement was the wall gone.
And their story is similar to others in Seymour.
We've got quite a bit of damage on from the west side of town all the way through the east.
The mayor says it's too early to determine the number of homes hit, but possibly the largest blow to the community, the school.
The hallway over there is all done. Most of the windows in the school are done. We have a bus barn and a garage over there. They're gone.
The building's janitor, Terry Mitchell, was at the school minutes before the storm rolled in and was back Tuesday to assess the damage.
The thing I hate the most is our old gym. That thing's 100 years old, and it just wiped it out. I played all my basketball games and stuff in there, and it's just sad to see.
This is what it looks like inside the school's newer gym. Daylight sneaking in through the roof.
I've never seen anything like it. I mean, I'm 58 years old and I've never seen anything like this.
Don't touch your face.
And neither had dozens of the students and teachers who stopped by Tuesday to help clean up.
Coming out here this morning, it's just like, oh my goodness, like it's so much worse than what you originally thought.
Which is why on their unexpected day off, they decided to get to work anyway.
Let's go back. I mean, I didn't expect anything less, to be honest with you.
Got to get it done.
Trading their pencils and paper for trash bags and rakes, the entire Mount Air Middle and High School spent their school day cleaning up tornado damage in Seymour.
We're picking up insulation, sticks,
debris.
Yeah, a whole bunch of debris that happened.
The nearly 300 students crammed onto 6 buses this morning and made the hour and 15-minute trip to town. Students broke up into groups, spreading out across the hardest hit parts of Seymour.
school's principal says students originally came to her with the idea. It's part of the Respectful Raider Seminar, an initiative for students to help around their own community and now other communities.
If you miss the mark of teaching kids to be kind, caring, and helpful citizens, then you really have missed the mark.
In Seymour, Hannah Hilliard.
Plenty of towns claim.
Oh, it's so pretty. Oh.
They're family friendly. Claim a spot early enough along Pella's Tulip Time parade route, and you'll witness moms and their boys.
Are you being shy?
Uh-huh. Proving it's different under their Dutch windmills.
It really brings the community together.
Like one big family.
A celebration built not on the bulbs or the bakery goodies.
You know, the poppergies, the Dutch letters.
But the bonds that lure generations to the same curb every year. Ruth Bushnell and her girls are always here.
Then we got a son that's serving in Germany.
But when duty called, Ruth's boy answered.
You know, that's always hard because he was always part of Tulip Time too. And miss him.
She also had no idea.
Welcome home.
Thank you.
That just two blocks down the street, Sergeant Bushnell.
I've been very nervous and very excited all day.
Was home from Germany with his wife and 10-month-old daughter.
So now she gets to wear the little Dutch costumes.
Ready to hide in the parade on the American Legion float, headed straight for his mom's spot.
And after that, it's gonna be waterworks for my mom. She'll be very happy though.
Live in Pella long enough, and you think you know the entries.
Yeah, there's some floats. There's some floats that are same every year. You know, it's a tradition.
You ready for this?
Like where Pella's military boys march.
Yeah, I hope our son can do that next year.
Good looking men on that float.
She had no idea.
What?
Ruth Bushnell turned 60 Friday.
Surprise!
Her boy knew a simple birthday call from Germany wouldn't cut it.
Oh, I miss you so much.
So he packed up his young family. And flew 4,000 miles.
How did you pull this one off?
With a lot of help.
You nailed it.
For an 8-block ride around Pella's Square.
His folks weren't expecting Brian until next month.
For most of the parade,
aww,
Ruth barely noticed she'd actually been pulled into it.
I can't believe it.
She was too busy hugging her boy.
He'll be all right, I'm here.
He's home. I can't believe it.
Who had really come all the way home for her.
Oh, I love him.
Missy Murphy and her three children were camping here at Windmill Lake Friday night. She says high winds knocked the trailer over and it started rolling down the hill into the lake.
It was absolutely horrifying.
The mother and her three daughters were trapped inside this old fifth wheel that turned into a sinking death trap.
The girls are just screaming and I told them to hold on as tight as they could.
Missy held on to her baby,
hey, baby,
while her 4-year-old and 10-year-old were tossed about.
You know, I knew if I let her go that we would probably never find her again.
When they landed in the lake, the cold water started pouring in. They grabbed a mattress and floated to the top of the camper where the water was up to their necks.
Jillian said, Mommy, are we gonna die? And something in me, I mean, just in my mind, it was, you know, these girls are not dying like this.
The 10-year-old saw their only hope, an air vent in the roof, and started kicking it open.
I thought maybe I could get out, and then Mom could hand me Justice, and then I can get Meredith.
Once she pushed the girls through, Missy somehow squeezed through this small hole. She swam her 4-year-old to shore, then swam back, waiting on the roof of the camper for help.
I told the girls to keep screaming because somebody would eventually hear us and come for us.
When her fiancé Brad heard the news, he drove 12 miles to get his fishing boat and arrived just in time.
I'd kind of panicked when I seen what had went on because at that point I didn't know which girls had made it.
They all survived.
I got stuck in the slide out.
With cuts, bumps, and bruises.
Thankful that everybody made it out we can heal. Things can be replaced, but our family can't.
I don't know how to explain it other than God was with us that night. Just totally changes your perspective on life. We're very, very blessed to be here.
As the Boone JV team exited the bus before their Thursday night game at Carlisle, Tabor Brow looked as excited as anyone, despite knowing he wasn't going to play or even suit up. Tabor is the student manager, tasked with simple but necessary jobs that could easily go unappreciated and oftentimes do.
Not a lot of people treat him like how he should.
There you go.
All right, thank you.
Tabor is the Boone JV coach's right hand.
He's an awesome kid, fantastic kid. I wish I had 15 of them.
Doors on me, doors on three. One, two, three, doors.
Before a recent game, members of the Boone team decided Tabor deserved something, a thank you for his hard work.
Coach James.
Okay. A Boone coach's polo and a pair of Adidas basketball shoes.
That is so awesome.
Coach had not seen the video.
Makes me proud to coach these guys. That is really neat.
Tabor knows some managers are underappreciated, unnoticed, underpaid.
I get paid nothing.
Every time we travel somewhere, I buy him a sandwich. So.
So this new shirt and new shoes.
It was completely surprising.
From a bunch of teenage boys who stopped to think about someone else.
Nice shoes, man.
Thanks.
Let's just say it was appreciated.
At one point in time, I cried for about 10 minutes. Just thinking, wow. I never knew these guys would buy me something.
Mark Telschek, KCCI 8 News, Iowa's news leader.
About 1,000 people crowded into the atrium of Capitol Square Wednesday. High, low, and everywhere in between. To see how high some of the most elite pole vaulters in the world could make it.
It's great to see the athletes, and it's great to see so much support out here.
Between every clearing, every miss, the crowd showed their support.
I think it's the most fun to watch, and I really like how the crowd gets into it.
This is really cool. I've never seen anything like it.
Royal Prudence temporarily stole the show with her waves as she made her way through the crowd, stopping for hugs along the way. Not to forget, just over the rail, a serious competition where even the athletes know how to have a bit of fun. Stephanie Nolte, KCCI 8 News, Iowa's news leader.
Uh-oh.
When a state trooper says, uh-oh, it's time to get ready.
I have a pursuit.
Let's go. Just a few minutes after we finished an interview with veteran State Patrolman Thomas Clark, the call came in. A car chase near Perry.
In Dallas County, headed to Minburn, eastbound on Minburn Road.
So Clark hops in and is on his way at speeds up to 130 miles an hour.
Get up to about 100, you definitely don't want to take your hands off the wheel.
Problem, Perry is more than 40 miles away from State Patrol Post 1 in Des Moines.
They still got him at gunpoint, apparently being non-cooperative.
That means Clark has a long way to go for this first emergency.
Guess that it's going to be over before we get there, but we'll continue.
And he's right. By the time he gets to Perry, the chase suspects have crashed their car in a ditch.
We got plenty of help here.
Dallas County deputies took them into custody.
What'd he hit, just that?
And Trooper Clark's shift is only an hour old.
There's definitely more pursuits now than when I first started in law enforcement.
Clark started working at the State Patrol in 1994, a time when far more troopers patrolled Iowa highways. It's different now.
We're so spread thin, with just two of us out in six counties in central Iowa, that reality is we're typically not each other's backup. It's a sheriff's deputy or a local police that's our backup, and vice versa.
There's a couple vehicles there stopped, hazard on them. Turn around at 14th and head back, check on it.
It's not long before Clark spots a truck stalled on the side of Interstate 8035.
I'm a boy, Henry George 497. I think he's just broke down.
No emergency here.
All right, take care.
And it's back on the road.
10-2, it'll be 10-8.
Clark says with so few troopers on the road, motorists are in jeopardy of being ignored if they break down.
Just two of us in central Iowa, pretty slim that we'll be the first one to bottom or come upon.
7 years ago, there was one trooper for every 6,300 drivers on Iowa roads. This year, there was one trooper for every 8,300 drivers. And every year, the problem seems to get worse.
All the state highways are, after midnight, are usually not touched by us.
It's almost midnight and the police radios are pretty quiet.
time for speed enforcement.
I usually need at least 15 over to give it a ticket, and you can usually do that about all night long.
Wouldn't you know it?
95 traffic.
Just 5 minutes later,
Frank Boy Tom 924.
A driver speeds by at more than 75 miles an hour.
I usually go around the back of the car so they can't see me in the lights, so this is an officer safety thing, so I'll come around that way.
The danger is real, but tonight the driver is not a threat.
How you doing, Trooper Clark, State Patrol? Hey, you've got license, registration, and proof of insurance. Reason I stopped and checked your speed a little bit faster as you came around the curve.
The only trouble here, hearing the latest excuse for speeding. Clark has heard them all.
This is a rental car, and I was trying to do the cruise.
It's not used to it?
No.
Okay. Where are you headed?
Up to Ames.
2017.
And the process begins.
Unfortunately, my computer scanner's not working, so I can't just scan all this information off the driver's license. I got to type it all in, so this is going to take a little bit longer.
It takes about 10 minutes to do the paperwork.
And keep an eye on him at the same time. Mm-hmm. And traffic.
The lucky driver gets a warning, a consolation for being on camera tonight.
Just ask him, slow down a bit. Have a safe night.
Clark stops several more cars for speeding. He knows he's only making a small dent in a big problem.
They can really put the pedal to the metal, and it's nothing to get them 90 to over 100 miles an hour.
More tickets.
A lot of the fatalities are happening on the rural highways, which we rarely, after midnight, are seen on, just due to the lack of manpower.
More excuses.
We're at 65 zone.
I just saw that, actually, and that's when I slowed down.
Then just about 4 a.m. as Clark was pulling into an IHOP for breakfast, a new emergency.
And then they went outside and started shooting. Again, it's going to be 2010 Evergreen.
The shooter, the black male, white hoodie.
A drive-by shooting on the south side of Des Moines. Clark heads out hoping to help out Des Moines police and catch the suspects in their getaway car.
It's a white Dodge Charger.
Here at the crime scene, bullets shattered a glass apartment door and windows. The shell casings litter the parking lot. The bad guy's car is long gone.
Des Moines 1083.
And Trooper Clark leaves the investigation to Des Moines police. It's a reminder of the State Patrol's limitations.
Your effectiveness really isn't there. By the time you get there, the incident, even if you're driving 130 miles an hour, it's a half hour old.
But the job doesn't stop. It's almost 5 a.m. and State Trooper Thomas Clark is ready to call it a night.
That's a true midnight shift. You just don't know how it's going to go.
And it won't be long before the midnight shift begins again.
As the seasons change, so do the stages of grief. And 1 year later, a blanket of sorrow still covers the town of Rockwell City, where blue ribbons blow in the wind.
It's a beautiful place.
Yeah, it is, starting to fill in.
Jane and Randy Martin find solace at this walking trail near their house, a place their son Justin loved since he was a little boy.
He would run through everything, whether there was water. He was always just out here just messing around.
Happy memories get them through the days.
70th and Aurora, possible officer down.
But it's the memory of that day that still haunts them. November 2nd, 2016. Justin Martin, a young Urbandale police officer, stopped here at the intersection of 70th and Aurora Avenue to help Scott Green.
He did something to make Justin think he needed help, and that's why he was U-turning to help him. And then this is what he does.
Green pulled the trigger, gunning Martin down in his patrol car. 1 year later, the Martins say they'll never understand why.
How could anybody be hurting so bad? That's how they solve their problem, is to murder two innocent people without warning.
Martin's parents call him a deep thinker and a good listener. At a young age, wise beyond his years, with a sense of integrity that led him to become a police officer.
He said, I just want to help people and be part of a community, and I want to help people.
That's what he had his heart set on, and he got to do it. And not everybody gets to do the job they want to do and love doing it.
Martin's short police career leaves a lasting legacy.
He was a man of integrity.
Thousands mourn the Simpson graduate who showed so much promise.
You know, the overwhelming number of people that came to this house and were here for us, family, community, UPD. It was unbelievable, but it changed how we do, how you think.
The Martins say it's now a day-by-day process to get used to their new normal. But signs of remembrance are everywhere, from his badge number on this Rockwell City Bridge to the high school football field.
Pretty cool. see why Justin loved it so much. Yep.
Being outside is where Randy and Jane see their signs. The most powerful one came in July on Justin's birthday.
Started crying and I asked for signs that he was okay. And there wasn't a cloud in the sky, but when I said that, I looked up and there was his hand as a cloud. It was the only thing in the sky. So I put my hand up there, you know, and cried some more.